It is my pleasure to introduce my Extension neighbor to the north, Lisa Mason, who came to Extension in 2018 after working for a decade at the Colorado State Forest Service in their publications and outreach programs. She received her bachelor's degree at CSU in forestry and theater, and her master's degree also from CSU in entomology. So she's uniquely qualified to talk about forests and insects, particularly beetles that are affecting trees, as we'll hear about today. She's the Horticulture County Specialist in Arapahoe County. She's been there since 2018. Take it away, Lisa.
Okay, thank you, John. We have a lot to cover today. So we're gonna talk about two of the main beetles that are impacting our landscapes. So before I dive in, we are Colorado State University Extension. We are the outreach branch of the university. If you're not familiar with your local county extension office, I highly recommend getting in touch with them and learning about the services that they provide to your community. In addition to horticulture services, we have master gardeners, 4-H, food safety, food preservation, agriculture and natural resources, community development programming, and more. So the website's on the slide there. If you're not familiar with the horticulture services, we offer unbiased, science-based information and education, including diagnostics, fielding gardening questions, site visits, and public programs and presentations like this webinar. If you like this webinar, we do have a website full of live webinars coming up and recorded webinars that have already occurred, free to access at any time. So let's dive in. I'm going to talk about two beetles that wreak havoc in our landscapes. So a few things to keep in mind as we go through this information. Plant health care. The most important thing you can do for the plants is making sure they are receiving the right amount of care. Healthier plants will have fewer pest problems and will be more tolerant of pests. This particularly applies with Japanese beetles. A healthy plant can withstand more damage. And with emerald ash borer, while emerald ash borer will be deadly to all ash trees, a healthier ash tree is going to be able to be treated with insecticides if you choose to go that route. And this is a good reminder about integrated pest management too. There are a variety of options to manage pests like this in the landscape. And it starts off with right place, right plant, making sure that you're planting appropriately and you've got the right species for the landscape. There's lots of cultural care, weather, biocontrols, and pesticides that all these factors influence our plant health. So we're gonna talk more about that today. It's also important to note that we have hundreds and hundreds of species of wood borers in the landscape, and the vast majority actually don't kill the trees. Many of these borers will infest a tree after the tree or the plant is already stressed out. So we're going to talk about a couple of invasive species, but if you see holes in your trees or your plants, it's important to get a correct identification. So be sure to contact your local extension office because we can help you diagnose what's going on with your tree or your plant. Now, while many of the borers will impact stressed out trees and may not actually kill the tree, there are always exceptions. Emerald ash borer being by far the most deadly, especially, you know, for ash trees. But there are some other borers out there too that are pretty deadly to their plants. So if you have questions or you're wondering what's boring into your plants, give us a call. This is also a good reminder to consider water-wise landscaping. This is a super hot topic right now. And if you're considering making changes to your landscape to manage Japanese beetles, or maybe you have an ash tree that you're not sure what to do with and you're considering it removing it in the future, consider water-wise landscaping. You can add more drought-tolerant trees or plants to your landscape. Maybe you want to save on water and you want to plant low-water perennials. This is also a good reminder to consider where you're using your turf grass, and are there areas in your landscape that you're not really using that turf grass? That might be a great way to save on your water bill and reduce the chances of grubs nests or grubs living in your turf grass. A lot of the water-wise plants are Japanese beetles resistant. Other considerations when we're thinking about managing our landscape, whether it's for water-wise landscaping or just specifically to manage the beetles, start small. Irrigation audits are a great tool for your landscape. And like I said, right plant, right place. Okay. And it's never too late to xeriscape. A lot of these plants are Japanese beetles resistant. As long as you don't have an ash tree, you don't have to worry about emerald ash borer. All right, so start small. This is particularly important to note which plants are being impacted by Japanese beetles, and do you have ash trees in your landscape? For a lot of people, they have, I have three ash trees personally, and a lot of people have ash trees all over their HOAs and on their personal property. So consider small areas where you can remove those ash trees or save them, or maybe there's some Japanese beetles that are feeding heavily on plants that you may want to remove. Okay, let's dive into Japanese beetles. This was an invasive species. They can fly 1 to 5 miles on their own. So they're incredibly damaging as both the adult beetles and the larva. So that's kind of a unique thing with Japanese beetles is there's two damaging life stages. The adults live about 45 to 60 days, and the females will lay their eggs about 2 inches deep in the turf grass soil. This is key. The eggs must have moist conditions to survive. So we're gonna talk more about that. There are a lot of Japanese beetle lookalikes out there. And I gotta say, oh, this is heartbreaking as an entomologist. I was in a native plant class and the instructor, we were admiring this lovely dogbane beetle on a dogbane plant. And the instructor came up and squished it because she thought it was Japanese beetles. So it's net, you know, identification is always so important. You're gonna wanna note these white tufts around the abdomen here. This bumbleflower beetle right here often gets confused with Japanese beetles. They do look a lot alike. They also have C-shaped grubs. How do you know if it's a bumbleflower beetle? Depends on where you find those C-shaped grubs. If you find C-shaped grubs in your compost pile, in your flower pots, it is most likely bumbleflower beetle. If you find those grubs in your turf grass, it is Japanese beetles, most likely. And same with the adults, Japanese beetles are metallic colored and they've got those white patches. Bumbleflower beetle are much more muted in color and they are not metallic. Here's a closer up visual. Notice those white tufts and the metallic sheen on their body. I promise this is not what the grubs look like. It may seem really intimidating, but I promise they are actually much smaller. They don't get larger than about a half an inch. And how do you identify a Japanese beetle grubs? This is where you might want to contact your local extension office. You actually have to look at the rear end of a grub under a microscope. And there's a small pattern of hairs called a rostral pattern. And on Japanese beetles, it has a V-shape pattern of hairs. So I promise if you're not into grub identification, we will do that for you. Japanese beetles is pretty widespread, especially on the eastern half of the United States. Here's a look at where there are high populations in Colorado. Now, this map is a little bit outdated. We're going to come back and talk about the West Slope, but along the Front Range, there's some high pockets, particularly South Denver area, Broomfield, and the Pueblo area. How did it get here? Nursery stock that was transported here in the early 1990s. They happened to get established in well-irrigated landscapes and golf courses, and the rest is history. They are likely here to stay. Now, the life cycle is important to understand, especially when we think about managing the beetle. So the grubs actually during the winter time, they dig down deep into the soil. They're overwintering here and they're going to stay there until the temperature warms up in the spring. So they'll get closer and closer to the surface. You know, we're right here in April and May. It's possible the turf could damage some, the grubs could damage the turf grass, but most likely the damage from grubs will occur in late July, August, and even into September, depending on the weather. This June, July, and August, actually late June usually, July and August is when the adults will feed on plants above ground. If you're wondering about your lawn this spring, chances are it's not likely grub damage. Lawns are still greening up, and contact your local extension office if you've got brown spots in your lawn and you're wondering what's going on. Okay. Speaking of the lawn, let's talk a little bit more about grubs in the lawn. The grubs can be a major pest in turf grass, especially if the lawns are well irrigated. This is because the grubs feed on the roots, which limits the water uptake, if water can be uptaken at all. And this becomes apparent during when the turf grass is hot and we've got dry, hot weather in the summer. Kentucky bluegrass, which is a very common species planted along the Front Range and in Colorado, are heavily damaged from Japanese beetles feeding, but other cool season turf grass species are impacted as well. So what you'll see is general browning and thinning of the turf grass. Now, there are lots of reasons why your turf grass can turn brown. The primary, like 90% of the time, it has to do with irrigation issues and not uniform coverage for irrigation. But Japanese beetle damage can also cause browning of the turf. You may know if you have grubs pretty quickly if you see critters feeding on that grass. So raccoons, crows, starlings, they can make quick work and do a lot of damage to the turf. So if you've got critters feeding, there's a good chance you do have grubs. So here's some pictures of heavy damage. One thing you can do before it gets to this point, you can do something called the tug test. So if you have brown spots in your turf grass, you can actually tug on the turf grass. And if there's heavy feeding with grubs, you know, that turf grass is probably going to come right out of the ground. If your turf grass is pretty well rooted into the soil, it's probably not grub damage, but maybe there's some irrigation or other issues going on. So what do you do and how do you know if you've got grubs? It's important to know if you have grubs before treating, but an easy thing you can do is remember that grubs can only survive in turf grass that is consistently moist and consistently irrigated. So a lot of homeowners set their sprinklers for the whole summer and don't think about how much they're irrigating their turf grass. If you let your turf grass dry out for the first couple of inches before you water again, you're probably not going to have grub damage because grubs won't be able to survive in the dry turf grass. So consider that. That of course can help with your water bill as well. Consider fall fertilization because that really focuses those nutrients on the roots, and it's going to make your turf grass healthier and able to withstand or even outcompete grub feeding. And this is the most common question. People see adults in their backyard in July, and so they assume the grubs are in their turf grass, and that is simply not true. The adult beetles can fly 1 to 5 miles, and they have a good sense of smell, and they're going to find those plants. So you may have adults feeding on your plants in your lawn, but that doesn't mean you have grubs in your lawn. There are ways, if you have grubs, there are some very effective control options out there. Parasitic nematodes is one option. You can find these at your local garden store. Particularly these cruiser grubs, they will actively seek out Japanese beetles and help control those larvae. So consider parasitic nematodes. A couple other options are Bacillus thuringiensis, the Galleria variety. marketed as grub gone or grub juice, is highly effective against Japanese beetles. Now, milky spore, which is very common on the shelves at hardware and garden stores, is actually not effective. Research has shown it only kills 2-3% of grubs. So look for that grub gone or that grub juice. And application is key. So you're gonna wanna apply grub gone, which is the Bacillus thuringiensis product, in the late spring late spring into June and even early July, because this is the time frame when the females are laying eggs in the soil. If you apply it in the fall or winter, you know, those grubs are way deep into the soil and it's probably not going to be that effective. You can apply, we're going to talk a little bit more about beetle gone. Beetle gone is also a Bacillus thuringiensis product that you apply on your plants, and it helps control the adult beetles. Now, this is marketed as beetle gone. It does degrade in the sun, so you will have to reapply the product often if you go that route. We're going to talk about more options here in a second. Another very effective product is acelaprin. This has very low hazards to humans and pollinators. Again, this is going to be another spring application, and it will provide season-long control for Japanese beetle grubs, webworms, and bill bugs. Okay, so that is Japanese beetle larvae in the turf grass. Let's switch gears and talk about the adults when they're feeding on our plants this summer. Japanese beetles are generalist feeders, meaning they will feed on over 300 types of plants, and sometimes it is absolutely devastating. And that the reason for that is they have a style of feeding called aggregation feeding, where the beetles, one beetle will start to feed on the plant, and the plant emits a chemical smell that attracts more beetles. And so more and more beetles will feed on those plants. The beetles tend to start at the top of the plant and work their way down, and they are actively going to feed on the warm summer days that we have. So here's an example of Japanese beetles feeding from the top of the plant all the way down. Now, this is where the healthier your plants are, the more damage the plant is going to be able to tolerate. But, you know, it's still devastating to plants sometimes. This is a question we get a lot. I want to control Japanese beetles. Can I plant geraniums in my landscape? Well, research has shown that if the beetles feed on the geranium flowers, there's a toxin in there that will actually paralyze the beetles. In a lab setting, the beetles were paralyzed for a couple of hours and then they bounce back. In the outdoors, they usually can't bounce back. So there's nothing wrong with planting geraniums. They're a great plant. But there are so many other plants in the landscape that the beetles can feed on. It's not likely going to have control on their populations. They may prefer other plants. So not going to harm anything, but it's probably not going to provide a lot of control either. Pheromone traps. These are all over garden and hardware stores. Pheromone traps were originally developed to detect the presence of beetles or pests in the landscape. They really aren't an effective control measure, because what happens is there's a pheromone pouch in there that will attract beetles from all directions. And so you'll see a lot of beetles in the trap, and you may kill a couple thousand beetles, but think about all those other beetles that traveled far and wide because they could smell that pheromone. So they're gonna, if they don't go to the trap, they're gonna feed on your nearby plants. So they really aren't an effective management strategy. It's nice to see the beetles, you know, caught in those traps, but there's still so many more out there. Some people are insistent on using traps, and that's okay. Just make sure they're at least 30 feet away from your vegetation or from any vegetation, any plants that you really care about. You want to attract those beetles far away from your plants, not close to your plants. Another strategy for Japanese beetle control is hand picking. And I know this is tedious. You can squash the beetles. That will not attract more beetles. That is a myth. Hand picking and squishing is a great thing to do. And here's why it helps your plants. We talked about that aggregation feeding. One beetle starts feeding and that attracts more beetles. So if you're hand picking beetles off your plants, you can prevent some of that aggregation feeding and more beetles being attracted to those plants. So it's tedious, but it can help protect your plants. Pick and squish them to your heart's content. You can knock them into a bowl of soapy water. Some people, like if you've got Virginia creeper or grape on vines, some people have used a strong jet of water from the hose to knock them down. That works great. Just make sure you're hand picking and doing that in the early morning or evenings when it's much cooler. The beetles are capable of flying. So, and when it's warm out, they will be more likely to fly away. So cool temperatures are the most effective. You can feed them to your chickens. That is an excellent option. The chickens love them. Now, something to be mindful of. Japanese beetles feed on over 300 types of plants, and many of those have flowers that attract pollinators. So when we look at control options, when we look at insecticide products, you'll want to be very mindful of this because you do not want to apply insecticides to plants that are being visited by pollinators. We have a great fact sheet on Japanese beetles, and it outlines, there's a table for adults and a table for grubs. And this fact sheet outlines what the product is, what the active ingredient is, and what the pros and cons are. So look at that. That can be a starting place. If you have plants that are being fed on by Japanese beetles that do not have flowers, some of the other insecticide options might be okay. So be sure to do your research. Just don't pick the first product you see at the hardware store. You'll really want to do research on this. There are a couple of pollinator safe options out there, but I gotta say this first one, a Acelaprin to apply as a foliar spray on your plants, it is very pollinator safe. It lasts about 1 week, but it does degrade in the sun. It is very expensive. Look at that. It's over $1,000. So, you know, maybe if you share it with your neighbors, if you have, you know, high value plants in your landscape, that could be an option. Or you can also try Beetle Gone or Beetle Juice. This is the BT product we talked about earlier, safe for organic gardening. It only lasts 2 or 3 days though, because it does degrade in the sun. Very safe for bees. Something to keep in mind though, it takes a while for the product to kill the beetles. So once the beetle ingests the plant material, it's gonna poison their stomachs. So they're gonna stop feeding, but they won't die immediately. So you might still see them crawling around. So there are other insecticides, but please do your research and be mindful of pollinators and other beneficial insects in the landscape. So one thing we can also do is rethink our landscapes and plant varieties of plants that are beetle resistant. Now, again, keep your plants if you love them, but if you're thinking about adding new plants to your landscape, or maybe you have some plants that aren't doing as well that you'd like to replace, you can start slowly adding Japanese beetle resistant plants. Because unfortunately they're not going anywhere, and the Front Range has just provided a beetle buffet for the Japanese beetles. So do your research on what plants are less appetizing, and I'm going to show you a great resource here in a minute, but it goes back to that right plant, right place. You want to add things to your landscape that are going to be successful in Colorado, and there are a lot of plants here that may not grow too well in Colorado. Some of the favorites by Japanese beetles are roses, linden trees, Virginia creeper, and silverlace. Crab apples, hollyhocks, basil, there are other things too. The good news is there are often varieties of some of these other plants that are beetle resistant, especially with roses. There are a lot of varieties out there that are resistant. Okay, so when we talk about which plants can grow well in Colorado, here is a list of plants that are beetle resistant, but a lot of those are not suitable for Colorado. You don't want to plant an ash tree because it will eventually be impacted by Japanese beetle. Silver maples really aren't great for our landscapes. They're susceptible to iron chlorosis and storm damage. And so on. So do your research. We've got a lot of great resources on plants that do grow well in the landscape. Now, roses. We know roses are a favorite for Japanese beetles. Now, Dr. Whitney Crenshaw and Melissa Schreiner have actually done a lot of research on which rose varieties are more susceptible. They did a study at the Littleton War Memorial Rose Garden, and they looked at 183 rose cultivars. Here's what they found. They rated the rose plant based on Japanese beetle feeding. And they also rated it based on the number of bees that were visiting the plants. What they found is all these dots in the green box are resistant to Japanese beetles and they have low beetle visitation. So that's all good news. These are great varieties to plant. They found that some have high Japanese beetles, but low bee visitation. So if you have these varieties in your landscape, you may consider other insecticide options because bees are not likely to visit those plants. There are also varieties that have high visitation and high Japanese beetle damage. These ones are going to be difficult to maintain with Japanese beetles because the options are limited for control. If you have any of these varieties in the landscape, handpicking really is going to be your best option. And then we have these varieties down here that have high visitation but low beetle damage. And so these are going to be varieties that are that will do well in our landscape. So of all the varieties they looked at, only 11% of all of them, about 20, were high bee visitation and high Japanese beetles feeding. So here's a list right here. We can also, if you send me an email, I can give you a copy of the study, and that lists all the rose varieties. Here are the cultivars that were found to have little or no Japanese beetle damage. So again, these are going to be great varieties to plant in your landscape. And then these are the varieties that had no bee visitation, which opens up the door to other control options. Now, Japanese beetles and crabapples. This is the one where the variety that you plant is so important because there are beetle resistant varieties. The other thing to note is that crabapples bloom fairly early in the season. They bloom way before Japanese beetle adults emerge. So there might be some other insecticide options you could consider. So this was from Purdue University. This is the list of crabapple varieties that have high resistance, moderate resistance, and low resistance. And linden trees. Linden trees are one of my favorite trees. They are also pollinator magnets, and they're beautiful in our landscape. If you're in a high Japanese beetle population area, it's not recommended to plant a linden tree just because that tree is going to be heavily fed on by Japanese beetles. There are a couple, there's one variety that is less susceptible, and that's silver linden, but those silver linden trees can be hard to find. So keep that in mind if you are looking for a new tree to plant and you have Japanese beetles in your area. Probably not the best option. But there are a lot of other options out there that are beetle resistant. evergreens, all the varieties of evergreens, firs, junipers, spruces, pines, are not generally susceptible to feeding. Tula tree, oaks, red buds, box elder, Kentucky coffee tree, Ohio buckeyes. There's so many great tree options out there that you can add to your landscape that you do not have to worry about Japanese beetles. There's a lot of shrubs as well, hydrangeas, which can be tricky to grow in Colorado, but there are some varieties that do well. Lilac, privets, forsythia, those are all excellent options. You can also look at native shrubs as well, chokecherries, golden currants, and some others. Native shrubs that are fed on by Japanese beetles that I've personally seen are Apache plume and potentilla varieties. The beetles do like to feed on those flowers, but a lot of other great options out there. And then perennials. Now, remember when I was talking about water-wise perennials, this is, you can have double benefits by planting flowers and plants that are resistant to Japanese beetle and require less water. There are a lot of annuals out there too that Japanese beetles do not like. Okay, so what are Japanese beetles feeding on? My colleague John Mergel has developed a tool that we're starting to track what plants are being fed on by Japanese beetles in the Front Range. So you can actually go to this website here and look at the list of annual flowers, vegetables, perennials, trees, and shrubs. And there's lists that have no damage, some damage, and high Japanese beetle damage. So we'll continue to add to this. You can actually contribute yourself. There will be a survey link this summer where you can submit your own observations on plants in your landscape, and that information will be contributed to these lists. Okay. I'm going to talk about natural enemies really quick because I do want to switch gears to emerald ash borer. Biocontrols are an option for Japanese beetles. We can look at different options. Usually these are targeted specifically for Japanese beetles, so we don't have to worry about adding something into the ecosystem that could have negative consequences. Dr. Whitney Crenshaw is leading the research on this. One thing that he has released is a microsporidian, which actually is a disease to the Japanese beetle larva, and it has worked. He has seen some success. So basically what he did was he took infected beetles from Michigan, ground them up in a blender and made a slurry mix and watered it into the soil. And what he found is that it worked. It did impact grubs. This is back in 2015 at the research site. So that's great news. Biocontrols usually take years to become established. So we still don't know, will this have a long-term impact on the population? Too soon, but it is definitely a silver lining. The other biocontrol that Dr. Crenshaw is working on is a tachinid fly. Tachinid flies are a parasitoid on targets on their host insects. So this species here finds a Japanese beetle adult, lays an egg, the egg hatches, and then that tachinid fly, the larva, feeds on the adult Japanese beetles. So too soon to know if this will be effective on the numbers, but we certainly are hopeful. Now, before we switch gears, I do want to bring up Japanese beetles have been confirmed as of last summer, last July, in Grand Junction. Why does this matter? Let's look at the history of Japanese beetles. They were first detected in Palisade back in 2002. The town of Palisade was able to successfully eradicate Japanese beetle. They were a small community. Everybody had to do their part to treat for the beetles, and they were successfully eradicated. In 2005, it was discovered in Denver, and it quickly became established throughout the Front Range. And then back in last summer is when it was detected by Grand Junction by the Colorado Department of Agriculture. Now, one reason they were successfully able to eradicate it in Palisade is because they established the Upper Grand Valley Pest Control District. And the reason for this was to protect all the commercial growers from insects and disease and weeds. And so they are able to help control pests and determine presence of pests in that area. This is a very important economic area in Colorado. They grow so much produce in this area. Here's a look at the trapping efforts to detect the presence of Japanese beetles. This is kind of a cool graph to see just how successful they were. So now, what do we do? A breeding population has been found within the city of Grand Junction. They found 239 adults in four or five traps last summer. So it has not been detected in the Upper Grand Valley Pest Control District in Palisade yet, but Palisade and Grand Junction aren't that far away. So what does this mean? It means if you live in Mesa County, check out their website, get in touch with the extension office there. You can actually fill out a consent form to allow for treatment and trapping for Japanese beetles. And if you go to the Mesa County website, they do have an interactive map there to show where they are doing treatments. If you're outside of the city of Grand Junction, very important to apply grub control to your lawn and help, you know, do your part to be part of the solution so the population cannot spread. This is a good time to remember that grubs cannot survive in dry out turf grass. So consider drying out your turf grass. Grubs cannot survive if your turf grass is dry. And this is also a good reminder for those on the Front Range that might be traveling to the West Slope. You've got to purchase your plant material locally because it likely got to Grand Junction from someone bringing infested turf grass or other plant material to the West Slope. There's a lot of new developments on the West Slope, and it would have been an easy thing to do. So buy your plant material locally. If you're traveling from the Front Range to the West Slope, do not transport plant material unless it is certified pest-free nursery stock. So tell your neighbors and we'll all do our part to help the West Slope eradicate Japanese beetles. If you live in Mesa County, they actually have a citizen science project going. So there's a QR code on the screen. Scan it with your phone and learn how you can be part of the solution. If you are living on the West Slope and you have more questions about Japanese beetles, contact our colleague, Melissa Schreiner. She is the West Slope entomologist housed in Mesa County. You can also contact Teresa, who is the Japanese beetle eradication coordinator in Mesa County. And if you're outside if you're on the Front Range or in any other county and you have questions about Japanese beetles, this is where contacting your local county extension office is a great resource. We also have a variety of publications on the website. Okay, let's switch gears and fly through emerald ash borer. This is another invasive beetle and it is deadly to ash trees. It will likely kill your ash tree within 5 years. The healthier your tree is, the longer it's going to be able to withstand emerald ash borer, but eventually it will succumb to emerald ash borer. This was found in Michigan back in 2002, and it has since killed thousands and thousands of ash trees in the eastern part of the country. This pest easily travels in firewood, so be careful. Do not transport ash wood anywhere. This is its native range. In its native range, there are controls that emerald ash borer actually isn't a huge problem in its native landscape, but in North America, it is very deadly. Now, this map is from 2019, so it is a couple years old, but it shares an important message. So all these red dots and this blue border is where the confirmed emerald ash borer was, and then nothing in the Midwest, and then you hop all the way over to Colorado, Boulder, Colorado, and that's where EAB was discovered. That tells us somebody brought firewood from one of the infested states to Colorado. Since this map, emerald ash borer has also been confirmed in Oregon, again, probably through firewood transports. Current status of emerald ash borer, it is in Boulder, Larimer, Adams, Broomfield, and parts of Jefferson County. It is not in the Denver metro area or the southern Denver metro area, but it is likely to spread. The good news is it's spreading slower than we thought it would initially, but it's spreading slower. So that gives us more time to plan, but we still need to expect emerald ash borer to spread throughout the state. What trees will it kill? All green and white ash that are not treated with insecticides will be at risk. Emerald ash borer is really hard to detect. It gets the trees at the top first. So oftentimes arborists that are climbing in the trees are the first ones to find it because it's high in the trees where we can't see. And EAB populations, we have so many ash trees in Colorado that it has a lot of host food that it can eat. So it is going to kill all of the ash trees in the United States at some point. This matters because urban trees provide us a lot of benefits. I don't have time to go through all of these, but we need trees in our landscapes. And in some places, ash trees comprise of 10 to 15% of all the trees. People have spent, other states have spent billions of dollars eradicating ash trees and treating ash trees with insecticides. Just in Ohio alone, they estimate about $3 billion in property value and ecological services was lost due to emerald ash borer in Ohio. A lot of you probably remember Dutch elm disease. We lost about 200 million elm trees with emerald ash borer. We're looking at a loss of about 7.5 billion ash trees. So let's talk about the life cycle and what you can do. So adults will fly this summer, May through September usually, and they will find new host trees and lay their eggs inside the tree. These larvae will feed on the ash tree and they will pupate. They go through a full metamorphosis and then they will emerge the following season. This is a look at the very first tree that EAB was found. It was in Boulder County back in 2013. First thing you need to know, do you have an ash tree? Ash trees have leaves with 5 to 9 leaflets. They have a lightly serrated edge. They have the diamond-shaped bark. If you look at the branching, they have opposite branching. And the female trees will produce seeds. Emerald ash borer signs, some of the more subtle signs can be bark splitting, epicormic shoots throughout the tree, and of course, galleries. Now, ash trees are really stressed out all the time in Colorado, just due to our climate, due to how they're planted, due to all the infrastructure that we have in urban areas. So you will come across stressed out ash trees with some of these signs. That doesn't necessarily mean they have emerald ash borer. So you're going to want to look for those D-shaped exit holes. That is a given. Now there are D-shaped exit holes on other species of trees. So important to identify your tree and then identify the pest. If you think you have emerald ash borer, call your local extension office and we will get in touch with the people that need to know so we can confirm if there's emerald ash borer or not. If you see adults flying this summer, there could be emerald ash borer nearby. Now keep in mind, this is an emerald green beetle. We have a lot of lookalikes out there. You may also see some woodpecker damage on your ash tree. Again, there are other wood borers that will bore into an ash tree. So a correct diagnosis is key. Now, it takes a long time. It may take many, many years for emerald ash borer to actually kill a tree. So over time, you may notice a decrease in the leaf size. This can be very subtle, though. So, and if your tree's stressed out for other reasons, it could be from emerald ash borer, or it might be from weather, drought stress, other factors. So this is a look of the decrease in tree canopy over time. This is important because research has shown that one of the insecticides, emamectin benzoate, you can actually apply to your tree after the tree has been infested with emerald ash borer, as long as it has not lost about 30% of its tree canopy. So what does that mean? Keep an eye on the health of your ash tree and watch for thinning. This is good to know if you want to treat your ash tree, but also trees that are thinned out, maybe for other reasons, like from drought stress, they may not be good candidates for insecticide treatments. So it's good to watch for the health of your tree. Like I said, ash trees can be stressed out due to other reasons like drought, freezing injuries, and cultural practices. Drought stress is huge, and our ash trees need supplemental water. So why is it so difficult to detect? Emerald ash borer will attack the trees from the top, and it can take this several years for the trees to actually show symptoms. And there's not a good way, we don't have pheromone traps like we do for Japanese beetles. So it can be hard to detect. So here's your pop quiz. Out of all these trees, which of them has emerald ash borer? Due to time, I'm gonna answer that. None of these trees have emerald ash borer. This shows how, look at this tree. This tree obviously has root damage and is probably drought stressed in the landscape due to infrastructure. Ash trees can really struggle. So if you've got ash trees in your landscape, identify them and keep an eye on them. There are also other pests that impact ash trees. None are as deadly, though, as emerald ash borer. You may have ash bark beetle. If you have tiny pinholes in some of your ash tree branches, you probably have ash bark beetle. These will contribute to branch dieback, but rarely would kill the tree. More commonly, almost every single ash tree has lilac ash borer, which is actually a clear wing moth. It's not a beetle at all. If you have pencil eraser sized circles along the trunk of your ash tree, that is lilac ash borer. They are a secondary pest, meaning your tree was a little stressed out first and the lilac ash borer thought, I'm going to come in because this will be a good home. The only time lilac ash borer would really kill a tree is if the ash tree was recently transplanted or it is severely stressed out. If you have lilac ash borer, the best thing you can do is look at your cultural practices. How are you caring for that tree? How much are you watering it to improve the health? And Cytopsera canker can also impact ash trees. So here are some pictures. So I said lilac ash borer was a clear wing moth. It looks like a wasp, I know, but a clear wing moth. Sometimes you'll see the pupal skin on the ash tree. Again, this is lilac ash borer that is not nearly, it is not deadly like emerald ash borer. No control is needed most of the time. Instead of a control option, the better question to ask is, how can I better take care of this tree? How can I give it more water to reduce the stress on the tree? Flat-headed apple tree borer is another common borer that's associated with ash trees and a lot of different hardwoods. They have very distinct gallery patterns, but again, this is a secondary pest and it is not going to kill your tree. Here's those ash bark beetles that I mentioned. Look at those tiny pinholes. Again, this may contribute to some limb dieback, but it is not going to be the death of your tree. Little green metallic beetles. There are so many out there. If you see a green metallic beetle, try to catch it and send it to your extension office or send it to the plant diagnostic clinic to get an ID confirmation. So if you have ash trees, what should you do? The best thing you can do is start making a plan for your trees now. Because if you do have ash trees, it will be a financial cost to you at some point in the future. Doesn't have to be right now though, unless you're in a county where emerald ash borer is confirmed. If you live in Boulder, Arvada, parts of Larimer County, if you have emerald ash borer in your area, you will need to make a decision sooner than later if you haven't already. If you do not have emerald ash borer in your county, you've got some time to plan. First question to see is, do you have ash trees? If so, how many? And what is their health like? Watch them leaf out this year so you can keep an eye on their health. Is it a high value tree? High value tree could be the size. You know, if you've got a 15 or more inch in diameter tree, that's a well-established, hopefully healthy tree. It might be worth saving. Is the tree providing shade to your house? Does the tree provide sentimental value to you? Those are all questions that you should ask yourself to determine, is this tree high value? If it is, it might be worth treating with insecticides. If the tree is stressed out, it's not a high value tree, eventually that tree will probably have to be removed. So you could remove it sooner than later to save on costs. A smaller tree is cheaper to remove. A tree not infested with emerald ash borer is going to be cheaper. And then you can plant something to replace it. Removing trees costs a lot of money. Maybe you want to hold on to your trees for now and save up money to have it removed at a later time. So these are all things to think about. And then planting diversity. If you end up replacing ash trees, consider planting a broad range of species. That way, if another pest comes in, it won't impact all of the same species. And this is especially true for HOAs. Diversity is key. From an HOA standpoint, really no more than 10% of your trees should be of any one species. And if you do have emerald ash borer in your city, in your town, in the tree, removal is critical. So should I save my tree? We talked about that a little bit. So one thing to consider, if it is a high value tree and you do want to save it, when should you start treatments? This is a great question. If emerald ash borer is nearby and in your county, you can start treating now. If emerald ash borer has not been confirmed and it's still quite a distance away, you could probably wait. If you've got a healthy tree, remember, as long as you haven't lost more than 30% of the tree canopy, you can wait to treat that tree after emerald ash borer is confirmed in your area or after emerald ash borer has infested your tree. So it really comes down to peace of mind. If that tree is very special to you and you want to keep it at all costs and it's worth it to start treating now, that might be an option. But if you're looking to save money, you don't want the extra financial burden right now, you can wait and to treat till emerald ash borer gets closer to your area. So a lot of factors to consider. If you decide you want to save your trees, we have a great fact sheet, Insecticides Used to Control Emerald Ash Borer. This walks you through the four different insecticide options, the pros and cons, so you can determine what might be appropriate for you. Most likely, you're going to have to hire a professional, a certified arborist to do the insecticide applications. There is one treatment option available to consumer homeowners. But if you have a large tree, the formula of that is probably not going to be strong enough to effectively treat your ash tree. So it's best to consult a certified arborist for control options. Some of the insecticides are harmful to pollinators. So this tree right here, you would not want to apply a soil drench or a trunk spray, because if those insecticides come into contact with the flowers, it is going to harm the bees and other beneficial insects. The other thing to consider too is the soil drenches, the middle culprit variety. The product actually bonds to organic matter. So the more mulch and plant material you have underneath your tree, the less the tree is going to be able to uptake, because these are all systemic insecticides, meaning the roots have to uptake the product for it to be effective. No matter what product you end up applying, you need to keep your tree well watered, because a well-watered tree will be able to uptake those products more effectively. So what can you do? Make a plan for your ash trees now and contact Extension if you're not sure what to do. Make sure you're watering your ash trees and taking good care of them, because a healthier tree will be able to last longer in the landscape. Talk to your family, your neighbors, your community, your HOA board, because now's the time to make a plan for emerald ash borer if you have not already. Here's a few websites in addition to CSU Extension. There's also a free app that will help you identify if you have an ash tree. So check that out. And I ended right at 1 o'clock. Okay, so we can take one or two questions before we end. Thank you all very much for attending today.